How do you become a keynote at such a wonderful congress? You have to do two things. First, you have to move to a tiny destination, a quirky one. And secondly, it helps when another keynote, say from Denmark, gives the message 2 weeks before the congress that she can't make it. Then you get a phone call of the people of Destination Think, and they remember me from their congresses in Europe, and I was also in Australia, and they ask very politely if you could replace someone else. That's good for your ego, of course. And then you pretend to hesitate a very long time, let's say 3 seconds, and then you answer yes. And the second question is, what do you think of a title for your presentation? You say, well, the same as always, I will do something about marketing in the future. And before you know, 2 days before you have to present, there is the title, The Future of Marketing. You think, oh my God, what a cheesy title is this. And then you come on stage and you notice that the previous speaker has stolen all your lines because it was all there. It was a great job you've done there, Kirsty. So, and it's the end of the day, you're tired. So what I want to suggest is just skip this presentation and let's ask about the future of marketing to the people of tomorrow.
Towards the end of July, a brilliant scientist discovered the stars were in perfect alignment to make the next step in the evolution of consciousness. He guided us to a mystical land between the shadows of wonder to be part of an astonishing gathering in the history of our planet. Travelers from all corners of the world followed the astronomer in his footsteps, where the spirit of the mountain was revealed, and all our dreams became reality.
had to come to Thailand, especially Tinder.
You really hope that I wouldn't come back, eh? How much have you paid for this Congress? Because they are not serious anymore these days. You know, you expect someone who will be talking about marketing and you get this stuff. Anyway, it's getting worse. I promised you I am from a very quirky destination, so I feel urgently the need to talk about George Clooney. George, it's an actor from the United States. George has two problems in his life. And no, I'm not going to reveal that he's gay. I don't read that kind of magazines. First problem for George is, of course, coffee. You are the face of the most famous ad for coffee on the planet. And you constantly say in the press that you don't like coffee. So that's a big problem. Your behavior is not on brand. It's actually more a problem for the company, I think, than for George. Second problem of George is Belgium. Because 2 years ago, George invested all his skills, all his talent, and maybe a lot of money in a project called Tomorrowland. And all the planet could watch the movie by Disney, Tomorrowland. All the planet? No, there was one little country where you couldn't watch the movie Tomorrowland. It was the movie Project T, and you know why? Because these guys, the organizers of the festival, were protected by law. And it was payback time, because they have a spin-off here in the States, nearby Atlanta, and they had to change the name, and it's now Tomorrow World. They also have a spin-off now in Brazil. I know you're in the United States, you like big numbers. This movie has been watched 98 million times. You know, it's a slight difference. It's not their most watched YouTube movie. There's one of 125 hits. They sell out in 3 seconds. 3 years ago, the server of the city of Boom, where this is happening, this festival, crashed after 3 seconds. There were 2 million people who wanted to buy a ticket, and there are only 180,000 people who can go in the festival. Why did I show you this movie? Because, of course, it's about marketing. These guys never ever in Belgium made any promotion for their festival. From in the beginning there was a business plan, and the moment they got break even, they invested all the money they could gain, they reinvested it in their product. And that's what you see. It's storytelling at the core. It's the end-to-end experience with an incredible laser focus on your customer. It's about an eye for details. This is a festival that every morning brings you a newspaper, the Tomorrowland newspaper. They have a fresh butcher, they have a fresh baker. It's about travel and tourism because they work together with a national carrier. They pimp all the airplanes, the stewardesses are elves. The whole airport is pimped in the Tomorrowland brand, the colors, the elves, the quirky people who are there, and so on and so on. This is a lesson for marketing. So what these guys discovered 10 years ago is that there is no future for a one-size-fits-all marketing. And that's what I want to talk with you about the next 20 minutes. I promised you to talk about an experience of mine. I've been consulting for years, the CEO and the management team of Visit Flanders. And what is change? What is transforming actually? And I thought, how can I symbolize this? And this is a hero of my youth, of course. And I know some of you will recognize him because they have made a remake. It's Bumblebee. It's a transformer. And he's an Autobot. So he has actually two shapes, two incarnations in which he shows himself to humans on our planet. This is the first, and here is very humanoid. He can show emotions, he can show empathy. And that's his other shape in which he appears. He is here, I looked it up, I don't know anything about cars, he's a Chevrolet Cordero. And he has that double aspect in him, humanoid, robot, and technological thing. So, for me, transforming is really about a combination of these two forces, being human on the one side and being technological on the other side. So it's about technology and it's about being human. So my point is that there is no digital transformation without a human or cultural transformation, culture always related to human beings. And I came up with a very simple visual for you just to make clear my point. What you see is here to the right, on the bottom, this is the typical company that is up to date with their digital marketing, their digital strategy, and they're very good. And these guys are talking constantly about widgets and protocols and software as a service and APIs and responsive websites and so on. And that's great. But I will give you an example of what happens later in the presentation. If there is no one behind those machines, behind the digital surface, then you have a problem. On the other hand, to the left, top, there you have social for the short term. This is the typical PR agency with already a laser focus on the client. These are the warm, wholeheartedly networking companies. They're doing actually a very good job for the moment because the clients feel respected, but they have a problem with the future because in the future they won't be found anymore. So here you see the double force you need to be, and I don't come up with a better word than real social. Why real social? It's not about social media, it's not about digital, and it's not about PR. It's really about real social, both human and digital. And you can play a game in your own company if you go back from this Congress and you can just observe the words, the semantics they use in your own company. If your boss is talking about automatization, he will be probably in the winning camp of the digital ones, but he will lose in the human side. And if your boss is constantly talking about customization, maybe he will miss the future by not being ready with his digital technology. So what we really need in the future is personalization. It's about human, it's not about social, it's not about digital. It's about an extreme attention for your customer, your visitor, and your potential visitor. So keep this model in mind And the rest of the presentation, I like smileys. These are the building bricks, the stepstones I used to transform, with a great team there, the DMO Visit Flanders. It's about product in the heart of your marketing. Really, if there are still people that believe that you can separate your product development from your promotion, well, they will be completely irrelevant in the future. It's about stories. Story is wrapping up your product. Nobody knows actually what a story is. I've talked to a lot of people and they think it's an historical fact, it's a narrative, it's like in a novel, it's like in Hollywood. But there is a marketing definition for a story. A story is an experience that uploads your brand. This is about content. Now, if we go down, it's also about symbolic action. This is about community. And I will give you a lot of examples about it, because you really need that, especially if you are still an unknown destination. The way you are going to tell these stories to that community, your tone of voice can be both subtle or simple, depends on your starting position. And again, this is about what you call branding, but I hate that word, so I speak always about brand value. What do you have to offer? And some people are going to smile now, but my classic question is always, what will the planet Earth miss if New Orleans wouldn't exist anymore? You have to answer that question. And the last stage of the transformation, and maybe the most important one, is a sort of thread that you weave throughout the whole marketing, that is personalization. Now, I promised you already, I will talk to you about a case. I'm from Belgium. In the north, 6.5 million people. We try to speak Dutch and we call it Flemish. In the south, 4.5 million people, they try to speak French, but they call it Wallonian. For those who are really good in counting, there's still 1 million missing. Where are they? They are in the center, in a multilingual city called Brussels, the capital of Belgium, the capital of Europe, headquarters of the NATO, etc., etc. That's not the whole story. After World War II, just after Adolf H. had left the building, the powers that were, France, Great Britain, United States, and Russia, decided to give Belgium a sort of makeup present, and we got a German-speaking community of 80,000 people, the best protected minority on the planet, because they have their own parliament. Anyway, German is an official language in Belgium, and that's why people like me are trilingual. Now, you say always in the United States, Houston, we have a problem. We say in Europe, Flanders, you have a problem. Because, and I challenge you, take your browser in Google, type Flanders, and you have seen it already, you will see this guy. That's really a problem. You don't want to be associated as a destination with such a guy. He's irritating guy, he's conservative guy, only the color is right. This is the color of Flanders, yellow. So what to do about it? Come on, guys, start and build awareness and build some more knowledge about your destination. And like the guys of Tomorrowland, I'm a big believer of product marketing. Put your product in the heart of your marketing. So marketing is about making choices, not telling everything always to everybody. So we made that choice and we put up front and in the heart of our marketing the art cities. This is niching your marketing. This is a courageous choice, because we know that not everybody on the planet is keen of narrow streets, cobblestones, old houses, old town halls, castles, monasteries, and so on. Not everybody on the planet is interested in dead painters. But anyway, there is interest all over the globe for this kind of interesting content. This is more niche than ever. You might not know that, but the city of Antwerp, where I live, is top of mind after Milan and Paris for fashion in Europe. We had, just lucky, we had the Antwerp 6 in the 80s, and they're very renowned very famous designers. Michelle Obama wears their clothes. Bono of U2 wears their clothes. The zoo tour for the specialists was designed by Walt, and so on and so on. But we're not stupid. Embrace the cliches about your destination. We know very well, if you know Belgium, you always come up with two things, don't you? Chocolate and beer. So we put chocolate and beer in our marketing. And maybe subtle, it's Belgian chocolate. We don't speak about Flemish chocolate, as there is such a strong brand already, Belgian chocolate, and we speak about Belgian beer. That's your product. That's the first step. The second step is about subtlety, tone of voice, brand value. If we take Flanders away, what do we have to offer to the planet? And then I did something very strange, and a lot of people were shocked, and now they are happy. I said, we are no longer the country of chocolate anymore. No, we are the country of the chocolate makers, chocolatier. This guy is world famous. It's Dominique Persona. 10 years ago, the Rolling Stones played their last concert ever in Belgium. After that, they came 9 times back. And they wanted absolutely to try the chocolate shooter, because it reminded them of their youth, you know, sniffing substances that make you happy. It does. I tried it. It does something with your brain. But Dominic is much more than that. He makes lipstick of chocolate. He makes carpets of chocolate, artwork of chocolate. He gives workshops. He combines Brussels sprouts, very bitter taste, with chocolate. He combines poppy seeds branding with chocolate. Chocolatier, it's about cutting-edge craftsmanship. It's about the people. And when I arrived at the DMO, Visit Flanders, they were making a lot of photos on Flickr. Instagram didn't exist then. And they were all empty, empty towns and empty castles and so on. So now it's about the people. It's about cutting-edge craftsmanship. It's about the skill that makes people thrill. And the same with beer. We are no longer the country of the beer. Please leave that to the Germans with their big volumes, Ein Maß Bier, Humpa Humpa, Oktoberfeste. Leave that to the Czech people. They invented something like Pils in the city of Pilsen, you know, the very light lager beer. Leave that to the Dutch with Heineken. No, not Heineken, because still have to talk about beer. Anyway, this is the country with the most microbrewers on the planet. This is the country with the most species of beer on the planet. We have 700 types of beer with some 1,100 different varieties. Do you know that if you drink beer in Belgium, that for every type of beer there is another glass? I can't drink beer from a bottle. That's cultural. That's awkward. We sell beer like the Scots or the Scottish people sell their single malt whiskey. It's about cutting-edge craftsmanship. That's about tone of voice. That's about brand value. That's about how you are going to tell these stories. Now, I have a good friend, and he says always to me, keep it simple, and he has right. You can keep it simple. Go to the website of Australia. What do they do? Are they subtle about the people and cutting-edge craftsmanship? No, they don't. It's all about boomerangs, kangaroos, wombats, koalas, surfer boys, and that kind of stuff. And they are right, because they are very famous, strong-branded icons of their destination. The same for my neighbors, Holland. What they do is they sell themselves with windmills, wooden shoes, cheese, and tulips. If you go in Europe to the biggest trade fair of tourism, WTM, you always see the stand of the Dutch. It's orange, it's ugly, it hurts your eyes, but everybody has seen it. And that's smart. But how many destinations on the planet have such a strong identity? So you are going to accuse me, because you do that always. You're European, you know, subtlety, yeah. But in the end, it's about business and big numbers. So that doesn't exist in the United States. Come on. You're one of the most creative people in that field. For instance, this morning, so I inserted that slide, Cleveland, what they do is very smart. They embrace what others say about them. They embrace the reputation. I have seen Corinne presenting already 3 times, and she did it also in Europe. We in Europe, we don't know anything about Cleveland, meaning we don't know the negative sentiment about it. The only thing we know is LeBron James, because basketball is the American sport that is the most popular in Europe. So, and even for us, it works because you put the DNA of Cleveland, which are the people of Cleveland, in the heart of your marketing. I was yesterday talking to a young woman of Alabama, and I said, what would planet Earth miss? and so on, if we take away Alabama. She said, the people. And I thought, oh, that's very clever and very cunning of you. International Falls. Who knows where International Falls is? Yeah, I see some heads nodding. It's in Minnesota. There is nothing there. It's very small. But someone had a great idea years ago, and they looked for what is our competitive advantage. Is there something we can make a difference? And they found something. They have the lowest average temperature of the United States, and they rebranded themselves as the Icebox of the Nation. And they started with a sort of festival, the Icebox Days, and they do some very funny things there. They have bowling with frozen turkeys, and they have a 100-meter blizzard run with a wind gun, and so on and so on. It comes on television. It's something that drives reach, that attracts other people to go to that destination. And here we are in Texas, and I tested yesterday on some people who live in Texas, Clute. I'm from Europe and I know something about Clute. Isn't that strange? Because someone was so honest to make the thought that, okay, what is Clute famous for in the rest of the world? Actually nothing, nothing happens here. Hey, we have a lot of mosquitoes. So what did they do? They started a mosquito festival. I think that is a great idea. It's just what they are, and they do something creative with that. Stories. Experiences of your brand. I just picked 2, we did with Flanders. The first is the World War I remembrance. There is a poem of a Canadian, Robert McRae, and that says, in Flanders fields where the poppies blow between the crosses row on row. I tested on every Canadian, and every Canadian knows it. Robert McRae is, by the way, small ad, is from Ontario, is from Guelph. Now, we target here on New Zealand, Australia, and Canada, because their boys died in the Flemish fields. And that's exactly what the only thing we do here is online doing a Facebook, and we do something else. You can, there are 600,000 people, soldiers who died in Flanders, and you can adopt every poppy and you can plant it virtually on a website for that soldier. Now, someone said today that social or digital is less expensive. I don't necessarily agree with that, because the money we invest here, it's not in ads, no. It's in one person who is full-time working on this Facebook, reading everything she can get, interviewing everybody she can. This Facebook has 90,000 followers. Well, that's not that big. It's the Facebook page that I know and I've seen a lot with the biggest engagement ever. So people even don't like it anymore. They start sharing 50,000 times. They start commenting 50,000 times. It's unbelievable. It's the biggest organic growth I've ever seen. Okay, like maybe you dream to become an American football player or a baseball player. Every young boy in Flanders dreams to become a professional cyclist in his life. That's another story we tell. And that's niche. And if you don't believe in niche marketing, I invite you the day before the Tour of Flanders. Then you see it's limited to 20,000 people. 20,000 people from all over the planet, from Japan, from Australia, maybe from Palau, who knows, who come with their bike to Flanders to do the same stage as the professionals do the day after. Symbolic actions. That is very important. Do you need it? What is a symbolic actions? These are key actions that cement the future relationship between you and your visitor or your potential visitor. This is so important. If you're Sydney, you don't need it. If you're New York, you don't need it. But if you are Albuquerque, for instance, you definitely need it. So the mother of all symbolic actions, of course, the Australians with their best job in the world, and they keep on duplicating and repeating it. I think, I'm not sure, that Queensland was the first, and you know how it worked. You could really win the best job in the world. You should stay on an island in Australia for 1 year and post as much as possible. One of my favorites, of course, Iceland. And what they do here is very cunning. You know, they had a problem, they had a crisis, and they did a campaign, Get Inspired. You really have to check this out. They put their people in their promotion. It's all about the people. Ireland, the people with the most sexy accent on the planet, sorry, Australians. What did they do with the gathering? The same, community engagement. There were hundreds of projects that popped up in Ireland, and they just facilitated. That's what Faulty Ireland did. And there were very funny things like a redhead gathering, a beard convention, all that kind of roots tourism, and people coming to the country of their ancestors and doing funny things together. We did the same. Flanders is a festival. It's quite famous in Europe because it's our DNA. That's the way we educate our children in Belgium. We put them on a meadow, we make them drunk, bad habit, and we expose them to a lot of noise. We are a festival destination. If you too ask to tour, for instance, the Claw is made by a Belgian company, Stageco, because there is a culture there. We have, in 3 months, 260 festivals, more than 100,000 bands playing. We drink a lot. Tomorrowland, but there is more. There is Rock Werchter that has won 10 times the award, the Arthur Award in the United States for the best festival, and so on and so on. And we organized the biggest block trip in the world. And I have to go in a hurry here, but we invited about 100 bloggers from 13 countries. We mixed music bloggers, but also lifestyle travel and so on, social media guys. The results were amazing. There was collateral attention for this project. TV, television picked it up, radio, the newspapers, the magazines. Some numbers, there were more than 300 blog posts, and this is an old slide. That's the funny thing about social media. Sometimes it suddenly reappears somewhere on the internet. Unique visitors, 12 million, and so on, and so on. Now, we invested 180,000 tickets. We didn't pay bloggers, that's a rule. I don't never pay bloggers, but we pampered them to an extent and to a level that was really satisfying them. Tickets, whatever, hotel, and so on and so on. So the ROI of this project is 100. For every euro that I invested, we got 100 euro back. We did it with a metric that I came up. Actually, I had stolen it from Tourism Ireland. And this was about, you know, there was nothing in that period, and I hope that William will break that tradition. But you had the AVE for print, and what was there for social? So we built something around social advertile value equivalent. We came up with this figure, and we were saved by the bell because in the parliament they started to be grumpy, they're not serious anymore, and visit Ireland. A lot of interesting data came out of that big project. For instance, bloggers are different than the visitors, because here we see that Ghent was top of mind, followed by Antwerp. You should have expected Bruges, of course, and then Brussels. It helps, of course, that there are so many festivals in Ghent. You can do funny things with Twitter, you know. You see which moments are the most tweeted and retweeted ones, and you can see where your followers come from. the biggest influencers were, that's very clear, from the United States, from the United Kingdom. And there is one guy, and it's still a mystery for me, from Nigeria, who was not invited to the party, but still is a big fan of Flanders. And the last one is people please, customize, personalize, humanize, whatever, but it should be there. It's about designing your experience end to end. It's about designing services. This is a famous case that I give at university. We did research. We were filming arrivals of young people in the central station, train station of Antwerp. It's one of the landmarks. It's like a cathedral. 2 years ago, there was a lot of going on internet here in the States. Where is this place? Is this central station in New York? No, it isn't. No, it's Antwerp. So these two guys from New Zealand, on the flip-flops, they come outside the train and they're like, oh, wow, this is something they didn't expect that. So they were going from Brussels to Amsterdam and they see this. And then happens, we follow them with cameras, with a zoom, of course, we're shy. And they go to the place where you can buy the tickets and they queue up for 5 minutes and then the guy say, don't speak English. And he points to the sign, and the sign says Nationaal Verkeer, national traffic, so they have to go to the international desk, and they go to the international desk, and after queuing up 20 minutes, he closes down because it's 5 o'clock. This is devastating, the whole experience. You build up, the expectations were low, they went whop, wow, this is great, and then you totally destroy it. At Visit Flanders, they did run a program to improve the behavior of taxi drivers with tourists. That's what the people in Iceland did, that's great. They humanize, they personalize a search engine. They launched the first human search engine on the planet. It's typical Iceland, 50% efficiency, 50% sense of humor. So they divided Iceland in 7 areas and the system, the name of the system is Ask Gudmundur. It's a big joke because they say the most people with the name Gudmundur, the most of them live in Iceland, which is logic, because it's an Icelandic name. But anyway, they have that sense of humor, and you can ask them everything via Facebook, via Twitter, via Instagram, whatever you will come up. This project is a success because everybody speaks about it on the planet. And then, and here you see it, this morning, no, I skipped that. Somebody asked me a few weeks ago, they wanted to buy a social management tool. And then you have Radian 6, you have Brandwatch, you have Synthesio in Europe and Engager. And what should we buy? And these are really, really expensive software packages. And I said, yeah, you could do this and this. And if you need to build it integrated in your CRM system, you can do that. But my question is there a strategy behind it? And there wasn't. So there was one guy who got that machine, and that what is. And my advice was, don't do it. What we did, we invested in such a tool at Visit Flanders, but we made sure that there is a whole team behind it, and we installed a 24 hours Tweedesk, because you are in that position that you have offices abroad, so you can play with the time zones. And if there is a woman talking about, in Colombia, in Spanish, about beer and Flanders, and yeah, we have to make that Boolean queries, and there is always, that's not a joke, not net Flanders, we have to exclude it. So then our social media manager can say, I assign this to our PR in Barcelona because you speak Spanish and you have to answer this. That's the way you have to do it. It's not about digital, it's about digital and human. If there is no one listening, then you have a really problem. And I'm really frustrated about this. You go to a hotel and you see this. This is also about personalization. They don't take me serious anymore as a customer, because what they do here, it's like in the medieval ages of the after sales department. This is a missed opportunity for a great touch point. So I come to the end. These are the 6 steps to transform your DMO. 2 are still missing. 1 I would call project. Why? Because I think in the future we will have much more projects, and the way we organize our jobs will be more in projects. Years ago, Ronald Reagan was shouting at the Berlin Wall, "Mr. Gorbachev, tear down those walls." Well, somebody is shouting already, in 20 years, tear down those silos, but they still exist. And I think project management is a clever way to do that. This means that there comes another type, another sort of leadership, situational leadership that comes with project management. One of the frustrations working with DMO is that they have to report to the government, so everything is with tendering or RFPs. But you need flexible budget because the marketing is about speed. So less vertical structures, flatter structures, and a focus on people. And how do can you get a focus on people by empowering them? So the guys of Tourism Ireland once said to me, I didn't check it, that they do not recruit anymore on skills of people, but that they recruit on attitudes. And my brother-in-law, who is HR manager, he recruits people in T profiles. And the vertical part of the T is about what you are, and the horizontal part is skills, because skills, that's something that changes every 2-3 years. Who will do a Facebook in 10 years? Who knows? And the last one, there's a message for everybody who is in the lead in his company here. Give people so much freedom that it starts to hurt you, because it's about trust, and that's a very difficult thing to realize. That's the end. That is the conclusion. And that's a formula. Now I do the professor thing. Yeah, I know. And it sounds very mathematical, but actually it's very simple. Here stands that your total experience is the sum of your product experience plus your external contacts plus your, and that is special, your internal contact. Everybody agrees that if you're designing an experience, that product is key. If your product is crap, you can ever do what you want. You have to develop what you promote, and you have to promote what you develop. I think that everybody agrees that you have to design your services, yeah? So, the external contact. But my point is, and will always be, that the way a destination treats the dwellers, the citizens, the inhabitants, will be reflected in the way the others see your destination. The way a DMO treats its staff will determine the result that you get of attracting visitors for your destination. So you can steal this slide from me. You can now go home, say to your boss, listen, that's what we got. That's a strategy of Visit Flanders. So, you know, you can explain all this. Basically, it should be simple, it should be targeted, and it should be holistic. I think I made that point. Okay, thank you. It was an honor to speak to you. There's just one thing for those who fell asleep. If you now go out and you, oh, what was this all about? Well, just remember this catch line. It's not about the followers, it's about individuals.
Thank you.